HPV, or human papillomavirus, is a commonly sexually transmitted infection. Though usually harmless, there are high-risk strains that can lead to cancer.
And Dr. Wendy McDonald is here to break it all down for us, from causes to symptoms and prevention. Hey, good to see you.
Always great to see you guys.
So this is kind of a riff off a last conversation we had about the young woman who was misdiagnosed with fibroids, and it turned out that she actually had cervical cancer. And cervical cancer is a result of having untreated HPV, right?
That's correct. So human papillomavirus, HPV, is actually the same virus that causes like warts on your skin. I don't know if you ever had a wart when you were a kid,
like
your toes or something.
Right.
Exactly, the same virus, but there are various strains, and the high risk strains are what are responsible for cervical cancer, vaginal cancer, vulvar cancer, and anal cancer.
So how does it get in our body even?
It's sexually transmitted typically.
But you mean like in the wart form, obviously not.
Sure. It's skin contact. It's skin to skin contact. But the ones that are causing those kind of like more personal, you know, cancers are coming from some sort of sexual activity. But yes, you're right. You can literally touch a person's skin if they have a wart, and that's how it can be transmitted because human papillomavirus is it's contact.
And can it go from that wart to more dangerous?
So no. The type of HPV that causes skin warts or even genital warts is not the same type of HPV that causes cervical or vulvar cancers.
Okay.
Those are actually low-risk HPV strains, so they don't cause cancer. Like, we don't worry about the cancer, you know, causing on our hand, like that kind of thing.
Yeah.
But the high-risk strains are the ones that can be more aggressive. And the thing about it is, you just mentioned, it's silent.
Yeah.
A lot of times people have no signs or symptoms. You really have to be screened in order to even know that you have it.
And to be screened is, that's
a pap test.
Okay.
And of course, we know paps are really only available to people with vaginas, essentially, you know? So, but clearly it can be transmitted from any human to any other human. So it does require us to not only get our regular routine screening, but it also is a great plug for vaccination.
Mm.
Vaccination is something that's available to men and women, all genders, all people, from ages 12 all the way up to age 45.
Yeah, we just talked about this.
We just saw a commercial for that
because at first it was really only
up
for teenagers.
And up to 26.
Young people.
Teens to 26. But yes, a few years back, they expanded the age ability, the person to be able to get it up to age 45, because they saw that there is efficacy there, that there is actually reduction in transmission to cancer. And then one could say, well, but what if I already have been exposed to HPV? Like 80 to 90% of people are exposed to HPV in their lifetime.
Okay.
So what if you've been exposed already? It still is going to reduce your chance of that HPV becoming cervical cancer.
Okay, got it. So, I mean, when we were kids, you never even heard about this. What has changed over the decades that people are realizing, oh my goodness, this is an actual health crisis?
Yeah, I think it's just the awareness, you know? I mean, we have access to the information highway, aka the internet, you know? And so we can certainly, you know, see more information. There's more studies, there's more data. And I do want to point out a study that actually showed that there was a group of a population that was studied that was over 100,000 people. 40,000 of the women in the study who were ages 12 to 13 received vaccinations, and they followed these women out like 20, 30 years. There have been zero cases of cervical cancer in that population.
Wow.
Zero. And then, of course, there's the control group that did not have any vaccination, and then there's the group that got vaccinated after 13 or 14, all the way up to 21. That population was still 2 to 3 times less likely to develop cervical cancer than the unvaccinated population. But again, the ones who were vaccinated young, 12 to 13, zero cases, zero cases of cervical cancer. So that's a plug too for us to have our young people, boys and girls, vaccinated.
All right.
So how do you treat the HPV? If you find out you have it, what's the next step?
So if it's low risk and it's a wart or something like that, then those can be removed, or they can be burned, ablated, they can be frozen, cryo treatment. But if it is high risk, and we're talking about cervical or vulvar, we actually just follow that to make sure it goes back to normal. Statistically, now this is the part that hopefully will calm some people down. Statistically, most of the HPV that's detected will go back to normal. A person can fight that virus, just like we fight a cold.
Oh, okay.
So it's not like you have it and you have it forever and it's gonna turn into cancer. Most people will get rid of it and their bodies will kind of rejuvenate and go back to normal. But there is a small subset where it will try to progress. And the thing about cervical cancer and even HPV is that it causes very small incremental changes. The time from a first diagnosis of HPV to cancer is like a decade.
Oh, wow. Okay. It's kind of like a colon cancer where it's super slow growing.
Super slow. It's exactly like a colon cancer, super slow growing. So if we can keep an eye on it and see if it's making those changes toward cancer, we can actually remove the portion that's dangerous and a person can be cured from it. Mm-hmm. But apart from that, like, big kind of invasive removal of a portion of the cervix, it's called a LEAP procedure if it's the cervix, then apart from that, most people will get rid of it on their own. They don't need like a treatment, they just need surveillance.
All right.
Wow. Okay.
So vaccine, limiting sexual contact.
Or at least condoms, maybe as a barrier.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
All right. There you go. Dr. Wendy, she's giving us all the information we need to know. There's her phone number, social media handles, as well as her website. Thanks, Dr. Wendy.
Thank
Always
you.
Good information.
Thank you.